Today we have assembled here to discuss a topic which relates to Indian Politics Paper 2. The module title is Emergence of the States as Autonomous Economic and Political Units in Contemporary India. So let me start with saying that how do we see India? India is a very diverse country. Among the most diverse country in the world, it has many communities which can be characterized as like the linguistic community, ethnic communities. Ethnic divides are there on the basis of caste, religion, language. Even script of the language has been different for the different communities. So given the diversities of India, it is not really possible to have a kind of all India analysis. Like to consider India as unit of analysis would be like too far-fetched. So it would be better to focus on the units of Indian Union. As you know, India is a federal country and it consists of 29 states and the 7 union territories. And all these states are becoming a kind of autonomous political and economic units. So today we are going to discuss precisely this, that what are the factors which have led to the emergence of the states as autonomous political and economic units. So first, let me discuss the political factor, the political processes which have led to the emergence of the states as an autonomous actor. We all know that in the last 30 years of Indian political history, there has been an emergence of the identity politics. And these identities have been mobilized and politicized for electoral purposes and also for movement politics purposes. And what happens is that these identities can be, as I told you, that the identities can be on the basis of caste, identities can be on the basis of religion, identities can be on the basis of tribe, any kind of identity, primordial identity, identity on the basis of the birth have been mobilized, politicized for political purposes. So the one, when we think about the identities, we find that most of these identities are territorially bound. Because as you know, in India, there has not been a much interstate migration. So we have territorially bound identities. And because we have territorially bound identities, and these identities are confined to a particular state, especially after the reorganization of the state in 1966, what has happened is that you talk about a particular community, and that particular community you find only in a state. Like you talk about the Reddy community. Now, Reddies are only in Andhra Pradesh and also maybe to some extent in Telangana. Reddies are not to be found in Karnataka. Reddies are not to be found, certainly not to be found in large number in Haryana or in Punjab. So that way, when you discuss the identity politics or you discuss the Indian politics, which revolve around the identities, you have to consider state as a political unit. Because, and as I told you, that especially after the reorganization of the state on the linguistic and cultural basis, now the for any study of a movement, whether it's a movement for economic demands or it's a movement for dignity, movement for assertion of a particular identity or for a greater share in political power in the state, you have to, or in India, you have to consider state as a political unit. There is another factor which also underlines the importance of the state as a political unit. And that factor is the kind of electoral politics we have witnessed in India. As we all know, Indian democracy is increasingly becoming an electoral democracy. In fact, Sunil Khilnani argues that Indian democratic politics and the electoral politics, they have become synonymous. So when we talk about the electoral politics, and especially as I have been saying, that last 30 years has been very crucial in the political history of India, in the political life of India, then you find that with the breakdown of the Congress Party as the dominant party, as you know, Congress was a dominant party from 1947 to 1967. Over the period since 1967, Congress has won the election, but Congress has not really retained the kind of social coalition which it had earlier. So what is happening right now is that with the decline of the Congress, in fact, all other political parties, national parties, have also declined, with the exception of maybe BJP. other political parties have declined. So with the decline of the National Party, the political space has been vacant, and that political space has been filled up by the state parties. And so, and these state parties, they always focus on the state, because their karm bhumi, or you can say their area of operation, their main concerns, the issues they take up, the kind of politics they play, the kind of mobilization they do, that is especially bound by the state's territorial boundary. So naturally, the emergence of the state party would be another factor which we have to take into consideration for explaining the emergence of the state as a very important, a critical political unit. And here you can also think about the emergence of the coalition politics. Under the coalition politics, now what is happening is that the polity-wide parties, you can call them polity-wide parties, though it would be very difficult to justify that, because even now BJP is on rise, but BJP doesn't have much presence in the South Indian states. Likewise, the Congress has a all India presence, but now you find that the Congress influence is shrinking, and Congress has not been in power in Tamil Nadu since 1967. And also in other states like Bihar and UP, Congress is not even number one, number two, or number three party. So as a result, what has happened is that all the political parties, they have to depend on the state parties in order to form the government at the center. Even now, when the BJP has got 282 members in the Lok Sabha, it still has a coalition government, because in the Raj Sabha, BJP doesn't have the majority. And in any case, the party understands that in the longer run, it would be useful to have the regional partners. So that would be another factor that you have, like right now, like you can see, since 1991, 40% of the seats gone to the state level parties. And even now you have in the 16th Lok Sabha, you have more than 30 parties presence who have at least one member in the Lok Sabha. So this is another factor, that the emergence of the state parties in big way, almost in all the states, and also the emergence of the coalition government at the center, coalition government at the state, with the decline of the national parties, and also BJP trying to spread its presence in all over India. Now this has also led to the importance of the state, because when the importance of the state parties increases, the importance of the state also increases in political terms. This goes like that. Then also I can refer to other factors. See, when we discuss about the state emergence in political terms, we should also refer to the kind of the emergence of the state level leadership. Because in Nehruvian India, we had many strong leaders, like, you remember K.B. Sinha, you remember Kamraj, Nizlin Gappa, you talk about Sheikh Abdullah, you talk about E.M.S. Nambudri Pad, you talk about B.C. Roy in West Bengal, you talk about Shekhawat, you talk about many other state level leaders who were really powerful, and they were not only from the Congress. As I said, they were from the National Conference, they were from the Communist Party of India, and they were leaders in their own right. They were not puppets. So in between, there was a period when Indira Gandhi was the prime minister. The state level leaders, they were not really powerful, because center had become too powerful, and there was a person-centric leadership, and it was a centralized, it was becoming a kind of centralized polity with the passing away of the old generation of the Congress leaders. But then now in the recent times, especially with the rise of the state parties, there is a revival of the fortune of the state level leaders. It's not only the state level parties leaders, as a founder, as the president of the party supremo, that they are powerful. Even the state level leaders of the national parties, they are also increasingly becoming very powerful. You can refer to BJP. You have Shivraj Singh Chauhan, you have Raman Singh, you have Vasundhara Raje. They all are powerful leaders in their own right. So with the rise of the state level leadership, you also find that state level leadership rise has led to the rise of the state importance in political terms. So I have referred to you about the identity politics. I referred to the factor of the coalition politics. Just now I have referred to the emergence of the state level leaders who really shape, like you can refer to like a leader like Amrinder Singh from Punjab, a Congress leader. So these state leaders, whether they are from the state parties or they are from the national parties, they play a very important role in shaping the party strategy, in shaping the party ideology, and also they have their own support base. And in fact, you would find that with the decline of the national parties, there is a great incentive for the powerful leaders belonging to the national parties to defect from their national party and to form their own parties. Because, how would you define the emergence of the powerful role played by the state-level parties? You can think of the kind of resources they have at their disposal. You can think of the kind of control they have on the organization, the resources, organization, the men. You just see the size of the state. Some of our states are as large as the countries of the world. In fact, Uttar Pradesh is among the 10 largest states in the world, 7th or 6th number. It has a huge population, both territorially as well as population-wise. So the state-level leaders obviously have a lot of resources, a lot of manpower at their command, which really made the state also very powerful. Because these state leaders, they are basically, their power emanate from their hold over the state. And that may be one of the reasons that most of the ambitious leaders, and you can refer to Mr. Narendra Modi, they started their political career from the state level. And now they have gone on to the national scenario. And that is something like going back to the Nehruvian era. Of course, there are differences because, one, there is a difference in the caste terms. Now you have the political leaders coming from so-called lower caste also. They are coming from the peasant communities, the farming communities, and they are not necessarily from the upper caste. A factor which was there in the Nehruvian India, when the Congress was the dominant party, it was a Congress system. That's one. Secondly, that the state parties have much narrower support base, because many of the state level leaders, like you can refer to the state leaders from Bihar or Uttar Pradesh, who belong to the parties which have really been mobilizing the people on the basis of the caste and all, they can be termed as ethnic parties. They basically have a kind of support base which is not really based on ideology or on the common economic program. The support is mainly on the community basis. So that's another difference, that earlier the state leaders were confined to the states, but they had an all-India vision, they had a nationalist perspective, and that's why they could easily shift to the center. But right now, even when the state leaders shift to the center, they always keep on thinking about states, and they are unable to get an all-India impact factor or all-India recognition, all-India acceptance. They remain, even when they go to the center, they remain recognized primarily as state-level leaders. So that's another factor which really explained to you about the emergence of the state as a political unit. Now let me talk about the emergence of the state as economic unit. As we all know, that the last 30 years has been momentous years for Indian political and economic life, not only because of the political developments. It has been a momentous decade also because of the new economic policies, the kind of economic policies, the reforms which have taken place in India since 1991. And these economic reforms which have taken place in India, they have basically led to not only decentralization of polity, but also decentralization of economy. And under the decentralized economy, Indian states are becoming autonomous economic units. Now you have the chief ministers going abroad looking for foreign funding. You have the state leaders taking independent economic decisions. You have the state leaders thinking out of box. You have the states like they are taking their own initiative and they are demanding more and more autonomy in the utilization of the resources which come to them from the center. So all these factors basically help the states and the state level leaders to exercise their autonomy and to give shape to the economic policy making, economic policy implementation of the at the state level. So that's another factor. And you can see that one of the fallout has been that we have now got this rich state, poor state syndrome, that some states are becoming too rich, other states are becoming poorer. And in fact, if you refer to the 1990s decade, the decade when the new economic policies got implemented in 1991 as a result of Manmohan Singh budget. Since 1991, if you see the 10 years graph, you have Montesinos-Walia paper, you have other papers also like Pranab Bardhan paper, you read Economic and Political Weekly, you read the academic journals, you find lots of articles relating to the regional disparity, which has Nagraj article is also there. The regional disparities really increased in the 1990s when some states became really fast-paced states, whereas the states like Bihar and UP, they really started lagging behind. And this has happened because some states took the advantage of a state like Gujarat, took the advantage of Gujarat, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu. These were the states which were not really so ahead of other states. But because of the new economic policy under a new economic climate, the chief ministers, the political regimes of these states, they took advantage of the new economic environment and they adopted the policies. They went all out to attract the foreign direct investment, to also attract the domestic investment, and they went from strength to strength. And right now you find that the central intervention is going down and the states are being asked to generate resources on their own. States are being asked to give the matching grant, whatever the grants come from the center. And as you have seen, the bodies like Planning Commission, which was instrumental in holding the control over the states, now it has been replaced by Niti Aayog. Even the distribution of the revenue, you have now the states receiving much more revenue than what they were receiving from the center earlier. They received more than 40% of the revenue collected by the center as a result of a tax collection and other things. So the states are now becoming economically autonomous, becoming economically powerful. It's another matter that some states have benefited, other states have lagged behind. So it's not like a uniform regional economy development. And that's a challenge for a federal polity like India, because the promise was, when the development planning model was implemented, there was a promise that there would be uniform economy development, which has not taken place really. There has been a much regional disparity, and there has been this rich state, poor state syndrome, which has come up. And even within the states, you have the regions which are becoming more developed, and other regions, other sub-regions within the state are not really developing a lot. And that is creating a trouble, that is creating a kind of heartburn and a kind of putting a strain on the federal polity and economy of India. So as such, to conclude my presentation on this, I would say that we have to consider the states as a political and economic unit in their own rights. And in fact, I would argue rather that one should need to go ahead and go beyond the states and also look for the sub-regional kind of trajectory, sub-regional mode of politics and economy. And there, probably, when we study the state-level politics and economy, we can have a better picture of the national-level politics and national-level economy. Thank you very much.